Let's watch now as Tony and Dave perform some of the radical tricks they've invented and see closely, in slow motion, exactly how they're done.
This maneuver is called a kick turn. It was invented about 6 years ago by Tony. It's a very basic maneuver. It's mainly used just to gain speed in between harder tricks. As you go up the wall, you compress your legs, absorbing all the speed and weight with your knees. You grab the nose of your board with your hand. As you pivot off the top on one wheel, you drop back in, letting go of the nose and absorbing the shock. After gaining speed off the kick turn, you can do a harder trick. This trick's called a hand plant. You go up the wall, absorbing all the speed with your legs, grab the rail of your board, bouncing off the top, shifting all your weight onto your hand, pivoting, turning around, letting go of the board, keeping your feet as stable as possible for a safe landing.
I start off this run with the backside carve, another very basic maneuver besides the kick turn. It's done by just hitting the top of the pool, coasting along the top, along the coping, and it sets you up for next maneuver by giving you a lot of speed, which you need a lot of speed on this maneuver. It's called a backside air. As you head towards the top, you get a bit more speed than a kick turn, so it sends you into the air. You compress your body and your legs, hit the top of the pool, go into the air, rotate your body, and then extend your legs again, landing four wheels on the wall. This is another shot of the backside air from a different angle, rotating the body, dropping the board back down. This last shot shows a close-up of just the rotation of the body and releasing the board, dropping back down into the bowl. This is a frontside aerial. It's opposite of a backside aerial because you're facing the wall. So you throw your legs up in the same manner as you hit the top of the bowl and grab with your hand, compressing your legs, then extending your legs and landing back on the wall to complete this maneuver.
As you can see, Tony and Dave are both top professionals. Now, besides the hours of practice that it takes for them to be the best, the equipment they wear is important for safety reasons, and safety is a main concern. One wrong move off these walls and you're out for the season. Broken bones are an accepted hazard in this sport.
The key to safety? Wear your pads and know how to fall.
I think that there's a very special technique in falling in that you never fall really stiff and hard. And when you do fall, you don't stick your limbs right underneath where all the weight on your body is falling. If you do anything at all with your arms or your hands so you don't fall on your face, obviously, it's that you kind of absorb the impact.
Pads are totally essential, like knee pads, elbow pads, wrist braces, all those sort of padding equipment for skateboarding and roller skating have to be worn in order to stay in good health and be, you know, a professional or amateur skateboarder. You have to have your body together, and these pads help keep everything together.
Tony, let me ask you a question about the board itself. I recall when the boards first came out, they were a little thinner than what you've got here. You seem to have a pretty fat board.
Yeah, well, I used to ride a narrow board too for a while when I was a kid, but we got into making our own boards. We found out that they worked better a little bit wider because your feet fit on the board a little better, and It's just, you know, a better surface altogether for your foot. When you're riding something vertical, you don't want to have something thin and wobbly underneath you. And I just ride them because of the size of my feet and stuff. I just started riding them, and I like big boards, like kind of serve kind of skateboards.
Yeah, there's more stability, I would think, on a wider board than on the thin ones.
Yeah, works a lot better. Plus, you know, nowadays people put a lot into their boards, so like they're making lighter trucks, which are what hold wheels on, and wheels that have perfect, you know, urethane densities to ride pools and stuff like that, because vertical riding is getting very specialized now.
Right. On the subject of vertical riding, weren't you, how did you actually get into an empty swimming pool and first start to do vertical riding?
Well, we just found empty pools that we, you know, thought about riding. They look like good, you know, good little walls to bank off of and stuff, and people would be in there doing carves and just carving around the bowl. And I looked at it and I just was like a smaller frame then. I was skinnier than everybody. So I go, hey, you can do more than just carving it. So I started doing kick turns back and forth and stuff. And people saw you could really surf a pool.
Right.
So then more people got into it. But it was always just backyard pools back then.
Well, the main thing I like to do when I skate, the feelings I get off on, I think, are the exhilaration of the speed and the power and the control. It's something that you experience just yourself because it's nobody else. It's just you, you know, up there going fast and just feeling great.